we translate as covenant in English. You got to remember that there's a basic fundamental principle, and that is that something is being translated from one language to another. It's by its very nature an interpretation of the text. In other words, for example, when we read any of the Gospels, except for a couple places where Mark said Jesus said Talithakum or something in Aramaic, it was written, the Gospels are written in Greek. And as far as we know, Jesus spoke in Aramaic. So when it says Jesus, and we're reading it, when we're translating it in English, so when it says Jesus said, take up your mat and walk, he didn't say take up your mat and walk. He said something in Aramaic that was translated into Greek, which in turn was translated into English.
Latin was in there somewhere.
And Latin, all these other ones are in there in between. And that's what happens with this word, berith. Okay?
You mean he didn't use the King James?
No! He didn't even know there was a King James.
Father, none of that was written down for hundreds of years. It was all just word of mouth.
Yeah, and so that's the reason why, if you've been in some of Did You Know That classes, and we'll talk a bit about this later on, I gave you a little, like our Sunday visitor, like three or four pager about how the Gospels were developed over time and how you start out with the actual events, Jesus' words and his deeds. Then you go through this period of time where the witnesses, the apostles, disciples and stuff, tell the stories. Then finally, the next generation, the evangelist writes something down. So the words are not exactly what Jesus said, because number one, they can't be, because they're in Greek and not in Aramaic to start with, okay? So they're not the exact word, except in those places where, like Mark says, Jesus said, and then he quotes the Aramaic word that was used. He's so reverent towards that word and the power of that word that he repeats it. Or on the cross, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, okay? And then he has to translate, right? My God, why have you forsaken me? Kind of a thing. Because he's writing to a group of people that don't know Aramaic, probably. So he has to put it back into the Greek. Why didn't he just do it in the Greek to begin with? Because there was something he felt was really powerful about having the exact words of Jesus. But once you put them in the Greek, they're not the exact words of Jesus anymore, because he didn't speak it in Greek. Okay? And then you've got to have it in English, in between with the thing in Latin. So you see what I'm getting at? Okay? So this is what happens with the word berith or berith. The people who translated these Hebrew books that became the Old Testament, we're going to talk about the canon when I finally get around to it on our list. Remember, it was known as the Septuagint. Okay? Written usually as LXX. This abbreviation, okay? They translated those books that were written in Hebrew and some parts of it written in Aramaic into Greek, and then they accepted books that were in Greek as part of the canon too. Okay. And they translated berith or berith with a Greek word diatheke. Now, that word, as far as we can tell, means both covenant, a pact or agreement, and also last will and testament. Both. It was not a good translation of the Hebrew word. Okay? The real Hebrew, Greek word should have been syntheke. S-Y-N-T-H-E-K-E. That would have meant only a pact or agreement or a covenant, and not last will and testament as well. Now what happens is you come along in Latin, and we don't call those books the Old Covenant books or the New Covenant books, do we? We call it the Old Testament and the New Testament, because the Latin translation of diatheke is testamentum, which means last will and testament. It doesn't really mean covenant. Surprise. And this is where translations come into changing meaning a little bit from one language to another. In fact, the Latin word shouldn't have been testamentum, it should have been Fideris. That's what means really covenant in the way that we're using it. We get the word federation from it in English. Okay? That you, a federation is a pact or agreement between certain people with certain obligations to them, like the Articles of Confederation in our government and stuff.
Fidelity.
All those words go into that. So, you know, so this is what happens. Every time you translate from one language to another, it becomes a kind of interpretation of the original text. Let alone, we know that certain words change over time, even in English, right? I love, every time the Thin Man is on, I have an old parishioner, Hoy Rosary, that calls me on the phone and says, "Hey, TCM is showing the Thin Man tonight." As you all know, I love Myrna Loy. I mean, I would have married Myrna Loy if I'd been around. I love Myrna Loy. She was wonderful, you know, and everything. And so I stop, if I can, what I'm doing, and I'll watch at least a few minutes of The Thin Man. I love that you know, the scene at the end where they're having the dinner, and he figures out who did the killing and everything else. And, you know, she says at one point, you can serve the nuts now. I mean, not these nuts, but I mean the real nuts. You know, this is a wonderful, wonderful witty scene, you know, kind of a thing. But she'll say to him, "Well, Nikki, you're very gay tonight." I don't think she means what we know today is gay.
Yeah, right.
It didn't mean that then. Okay? So words change over time. And so when you go to translate something into a 21st century English word or phrase, and you're translating something that was written in the 8th century B.C. in Hebrew, or we're going to find out when we get to Ezekiel, there are parts of Ezekiel where scripture scholars just throw up their hands and say, "I have no idea what this really says." But we have a translation of it. They do the best they can. Okay? But they will admit, like, in fact, the rabbis said at one point, "Don't ever read chapter 1 of Ezekiel at the synagogue." No, that's the thing about the chariot with the wheeling things and all this other kinds of stuff. They said, don't even think about reading it in the synagogue. I have no idea for sure what that whole thing is. We don't even know for sure what the Hebrew words mean, let alone what it means after we figured out what the Hebrew words mean. But we have a translation. You're never going to get a copy of Ezekiel that says chapter 1 blank. They took a shot at it as best they could.
Did you go over, I might have missed it, but did you go over, how did it get from Aramaic to Greek? Why did it go from Aramaic to Greek? Was Aramaic a dialect of Hebrew?
Yes. Most of the Old Testament books are written, we're going to talk about this, in Hebrew. Except for these 7 books that are written in Greek that we accept, that the Protestants call Apocrypha, and we'll talk more about that. We call Deuterocanonical. You know, like 1 and 2 Maccabees and that kind of thing. Okay? You know, and some parts of books like Daniel are written in Aramaic, and they left that out because God only speaks in Hebrew for those people. He can't speak in Aramaic, he can't speak in Greek.
But was that the first language it came from, the Aramaic to the Hebrew?
No, Hebrew's first.
I'm sorry, Hebrew's Hebrew first. Was first?
Yeah. Now, by Jesus' time, most people cannot read Hebrew or speak Hebrew, but they spoke a variant of that called Aramaic. Okay. So we think that Jesus went around the countryside, he's speaking in this variant of Hebrew called Aramaic. A little easier to use, easier to speak, and all those kinds of stuff.
And then it went to Greek?
Well, yeah, because what happens is, well, we're going to get into something else. To remind me, I want to come back to this other thing. The Jews get spread over all the world. The history of Judaism is the diaspora, isn't it? That's what it's called. They're spread out. We're going to talk about this. The northern kingdom of Israel gets destroyed by the Assyrians in the 8th century B.C. Those 10 tribes become the lost tribes of Israel that you see on the History Channel that become, you know, American Indians or something. You know, they're different theories, okay? But they get deported out, okay? That kind of a thing. A lot of them wound up in areas in which Greek was the normal everyday language. With after Alexander the Great, it becomes the universal language. I suspect that when Pontius Pilate spoke to the crowd, he did not say "Ecce homo," behold the man, in Latin. He spoke whatever the Greek equivalent of that was. Because in order to get into commerce like it is today, you need to understand English. If you're Japanese, the Japanese understood this after World War II better than anybody. We better teach all our kids English, because we want to be a world player in the world, and we better be able to speak English. Computer language is in English, everything's in English. English has been the universal language since the Second World War of the world, okay? It's the lingua franca of the world. Just like at one time it was French, okay? Well, Greek was. And at the time Jesus, Greek was the language of the world. Even the Romans spoke Greek, okay? And there was a big group of Jews that lived in a place called Alexandria in Egypt. In fact, there were probably more people in Alexandria than Egypt than any place else in the Roman Empire outside of Palestine. There were Jews, okay? And they came under the great influence of Greek thought, okay? And their basic language was Greek, okay? So the person who was in charge of the great library there in Alexandria came to the Jewish community and said, "We'd like to have some copies of your sacred scriptures, but we need them in Greek." So they got together 70, or actually 72, the legend goes, interpreters and scripture scholars and translators, and they sat down and took the Hebrew books and translated them into Greek. And that's the Greek version of the Bible called the Septuagint. S-E-P-T-U-A-G-I-N-T. Written usually as the Roman letters 50 plus 10 plus 10. 70. When you're reading along in a book and all of a sudden it says LXX, you'd say Septuagint. Okay. That's the Greek version of the Hebrew scriptures. And it was in existence at Jesus' time. And scripture scholars can tell you that when Matthew quotes from the book of the prophet Hosea, "Out of Egypt I called my son," he's not quoting from the Hebrew version of the book of Hosea. He's quoting from the Greek version of the book of Hosea. Or we know now with the new version of the NAB in Isaiah, "A virgin shall be with child and bear a son, and call him Emmanuel." The Hebrew says, "A young maiden in the harem will have a child and bear a son, and call him Emmanuel, God is with us." And you know that now because the NAB revised doesn't put the word virgin in English there. But when the Septuagint people translated the Hebrew word for young maiden of the harem, they translated Parthen, like in Parthenogenesis, virgin birth. And so Jerome translated the Latin version of that word virgin. Now, it probably means a virgin because the young women in the harem would have been virgins or else they wouldn't have gotten into the harem. But if you buy the new version that came out about a year ago, it's very controversial, and we don't talk a lot about it because we got enough of trouble with the new translation of the Mass. But if you buy the NAB revised and go to Isaiah chapter 7, you're not going to find the word virgin there in English. Because they claimed that they were going back to the Hebrew edition of Isaiah, not the Septuagint edition of Isaiah. Now, we believe in the Catholic Church that Mary was a virgin, and this is one of the prophecies that deal with that, okay? So this is not denying the virgin birth. They're just saying they went, and we're going to talk about this too. What's the right text to use to translate? Okay? You have choices. What's the best text? You know, as an aside, the woman caught in adultery in John, appears in some very good versions of Luke. And there are those scripture scholars that say that it may have originally been in Luke, and somebody copied it into John, and it stuck with John, and they took it out of Luke. Because when you look at the story, it doesn't fit with the other stories in John, does it? Those long discourses, the woman at the well, and all those other kinds of stuff. Okay. And it fits with Luke's version of women and how partial that gospel is towards women. It would, if you had the story and you didn't know what gospel it belonged to, you say, okay, we have the story of this woman caught in adultery that Jesus forgives. Where does it belong? You probably would say, put it in Luke. We don't know. It's historically now it's in John. And those other texts that have it in Luke, we don't use those to translate. See what I'm saying? So textual criticism, we're going to talk about what criticism means in a later class. Not mean critical. It means using certain scientific tools to get to a greater understanding of what the scripture is. And one of them is, the first thing is, what's the right text to use? For example, I'll give you a modern day example. What's the right text of Hamlet? Is it the folio? Is it the what-o-do-do? Is it the one from 15, whatever it is? Or is it the one from that? What is it? I remember it was a big to-do when Kenneth Branagh, remember he did a version of Hamlet. He had all these different stars playing certain parts. And he combined a couple parts together to give to Charlton Heston to do. Okay? And Heston had memorized this speech about Troy that's in there. He played the player king. And he showed up, and Branner says, okay, you ready to do the speech tomorrow? And he goes, yeah, I've memorized it. And he started saying, oh, no, that's not the speech. That's not the version I want you to use. Okay? We're doing a longer version of this speech. So fortunately for Heston, it was before the Alzheimer's kicked in. And he was able to remember the speech. But if you ever see the version of Hamlet, he's wonderful in that speech. He talks about Priam dying and everything else, and they have a picture of, I think it's John Gielgud playing Priam as he's giving this speech and everything else. It's a stirring speech. Nobody could have done it any better than that. But he's all along, the version of that speech he knew was a shorter version. And Branner says, no, I'm going to do the long version. And oh, by the way, we're filming tomorrow morning at 7 o'clock. it becomes important, what is the right text? Because remember, we're going to talk hopefully at the end about text. You know, this thing is written down. Then somebody has to copy it. And somebody has to copy it. And somebody copies it. And somebody copies it. And somebody copies it. And errors can get into the text by accident. You know, you come to the end of one line. Remember, he's going the other direction. He's going this way. And then he says, oh boy, nature's calling. I got to go. I'm a monk. I got to go where the monks went. And then he came back in. And he picks it back up. And he misses a line because maybe a couple lines all ended with the same word. And so he skips a whole line in that text. And then somebody else comes along and starts this copying of what he's got. Now that mistake gets perpetuated in every other copy after that. Or somebody comes along and says, I don't like the way Mark's gospel ends. Women left the tomb in fear and trembling and said nothing to anybody. We know the story didn't end that way. Put a couple of resurrection appearances in here. So we have three endings to Mark. The original ending's at 16, what we today call chapter 16, verse 8. And the women left with the tomb in fear and trembling and said nothing to anyone. But then we got the stuff after that, including the thing about picking up snakes and all this stuff to get those snake handlers in trouble all the time. One of them just died about a month ago, picking up snakes and stuff. You know, but then the church come along through that tradition and says, that's okay, even though Mark didn't write that, and we know Mark didn't write that, it's okay. It's within the tradition. Okay? And we're going to find out a lot of people whose names are attached to books may not have been the actual author of the book, but they're the authority for that book. It's not meant to be delusional. You know, this is when you go back and try to figure out how these books were developed over time, you learn this. That, you know, these books went through editing process. And they went through copying process. And it wasn't until the movable printing press that you could make sure that each copy of a book was exactly the same. Because you set your print, you just made copies, just like our Xerox machine. 25 copies of the same page. So you know you got exactly the same page as long as the Xerox machine is working right. Okay? But errors can enter the text by accident. They enter because the scribe didn't like what was there. Okay? And somehow that got perpetuated and carried on. So all kinds of things. So there's a whole thing called textual criticism. What is the best text to use to translate? Because we want to get back. See, in the Quran, I'm going all over the place, I realize this. In the Quran, it is only the word of God to a Muslim when it's in Arabic. So the idea was the angel Gabriel showed up, said, Jerry, write this, and you're Mohammed, and you wrote. We don't believe inspiration worked that way. We believe it's an example of the word of God, whether it's in Hebrew, Aramaic, Greek, Latin, English, German, anything. It's as good a translation as we can get to that text that we call the book of fill in the blank. That's not what the Muslims think. Once you translate the Quran into English, it's not the word of God anymore. Now, a lot of times in pictures and icons, you'll see Matthew at his writing desk, and it looks like an angel's on his shoulder, and he's starting to write stuff down. That's just a shorthand idea to say that Matthew was inspired by the Holy Spirit to write this book. But we don't believe that Angel Gabriel came down and dictated into Matthew's ear, you know, this is the beginning of the book, the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Son of, you know, that kind of a thing. Okay? But the Muslims believe that's about the Quran. And that's the reason why the Quran has to be in Arabic to be considered the word of God. Once you translate it into another language, it's not the word of God anymore. Okay? And we don't believe that. We believe that we've got a very good translation of this thing we call the Bible, of this thing we call Old and New Testament, as good as we can get, given the fact that we don't have the original of any of these things to go back to. Because for the most part, all of these monks and everybody else, all these scribes, really wanted to copy the exact thing down. They really did. They wanted to preserve this, because this was sacred. You know, now we have Bibles you put in your back pocket and you sit down on. Remember, and you see a medieval movie, you know, they've got this wonderful, beautiful book, you know, inlaid with jewels and all that kinds of stuff. Because there was this absolute idea of the sacredness of what was in there. That was an example in written form of the Word of God. It was sacred. You know, now we have little copies we stick in our back pocket and carry around. Stick up here and do all these other kinds of stuff with us. So we've got, you can feel pretty good that when you read in English, it's as good a translation as we can do, given the text that they're using to translate from. Okay? All right, is everybody all right with that?
It's a wonder that it's as good as it is.
Yeah, it is in a certain sense. It's wonderful. I mean, yeah. It's that because there's all kinds of things that could go wrong.
Moses could have horns. The main idea was, at least, the main idea is correct, isn't it?
Yeah.
And as far as the other stuff, it's just...
Oh, this is the word, this is the word of God. You know, we believe, we believe this stuff. But I'm, I'm pointing out historically, these things could happen. And we do the best we can. So we know, first thing is, what do we have, what's the text? Second thing is just to realize that when you translate from one language to another, you're doing a kind of interpretation of the original document, whatever that original document is, as best you can. And I use that to show what happened here. And then this gets kind of perpetuated in the testamentum, which becomes Old and New Testament. Because it essentially means like a last will and testament. Now, we don't have time to get into it, but you remember, Paul talks about how you cannot change a will. Was it Galatians or Romans or something? He goes into a long argument about that. So that God is still faithful to the Jewish people, kind of a thing. So, but, the idea was, though, that this was berith, meant covenant, meant this pact or agreement between two people. And testamentum in Latin meant more like last will and testament, which was a very good translation of this one Greek word, which was a bad translation for berith. And that can happen. So even though today we'll say, we're just in our own way, testament, we're going to equate the word testament with covenant. The old covenant and the new covenant. The Old Testament and the New Testament. Okay. Well, let me not do the breakdown of books. Let's go to the canon, since we've opened this whole issue up. The question then becomes, which books really are the Word of God? And which books are then sacred scripture? And what belongs there? Because you know that the early Christian community, and you know this by watching the History Channel and all these other kinds of things, were writing stuff. And not all of it became part of sacred scripture, because it was not made part of the canon. And the canon is comes from a Greek word which means a measuring rod or a rule. Okay? We say the canon of scripture, we mean those books that have been decided by a community, i.e. in our case, the Roman Catholic Church, to be the inspired word of God in written form, sacred scripture. And that's the canon. Okay? Well, the Hebrews started this whole thing. They didn't call it a testament, they called it the Hebrew scripture. And it appears to have been really two canons. One came out of the area around Jerusalem. A little background story. When the temple is destroyed by the Romans in 70 AD, the covenant, the Davidic covenant, and the temple as being the center of the religion goes away, because there's no temple anymore, so there's no need for a priest anymore. There's no place to offer sacrifice anymore. So the Word of God in written form, what we call sacred scripture, became very, very, very important. And so these people who were the priests at Jesus' time, like the Sadducees, who were very powerful, suddenly aren't powerful anymore. There's people in the Gospels that are referred to as rabbis become powerful. Okay? It was a lay movement. Rabbis were lay people. Okay? Hi, Eddie. The Jews go to the Roman Emperor around 90 AD or so and say, we ask your permission to start a seminary. They called it an academy. To train rabbis. Okay. And they do it in this little place outside of Jerusalem that's usually referred to as Yevne or Jamnia. Did you ever see the word Jamnia? It's the same thing. And they start this, they start training and doing everything, and they get it, and they develop a canon of scripture. And one of their rules in the canon of scripture is, I mentioned before, God only speaks in Hebrew. He doesn't speak in Greek. He doesn't speak in Aramaic, okay? And so they come up with a listing of what books then they consider to be sacred scripture.
Okay. Okay.
And books that didn't make it were things like Tobit and Judith and 1 and 2 Maccabees and Wisdom and Sirach and Baruch and parts of Esther and Daniel that were written in Aramaic. Was not in their canon of scripture at this place called Jamnia or Yet outside of Jerusalem. Okay. In Alexandria, where the Septuagint, the translation of those Hebrew books into Greek took place, they saw no problem with God speaking in Greek. Okay? So they accepted those. So when the Roman Catholics developed their canon of the Old Testament, they included those seven books, plus the parts in Aramaic in Esther and Daniel, because they saw no reason not to. Okay? And they then called those seven books and parts of the elders canonical. Okay? Meaning the second canon. Okay? And they included them. And for all the years of Christianity in the West, and in Christianity in the East as well, they included those seven books. Like 1 and 2 Maccabees are important because Hanukkah comes from them. Mm-hmm. The Book of Wisdom is one of the wonderful books, in probably the last book written in what we call the Old Testament. Maybe as late as the decade Jesus was born, some scholars believe. It was very late. It talks about an afterlife and, you know, and all kinds of stuff. And so, we held to that. Now, when the Protestants come along and they break off, of course, they want to do everything they can to seem separate from Roman Catholics. If the Catholics believe in sacraments, well, then we're not going to believe in sacraments, right? The Catholics have a pope, we're not going to have a pope. So when they decided what the Old Testament would be, they went back to this canon for the Old Testament that didn't include those seven books. But if you pick up a Protestant translation of the Old Testament, they'll usually say Old and New Testament, including Apocrypha. Those seven books are translated, but in a separate place from the canonical books, because they're not thought to be as trustworthy or as important or as sacred as these other books are. And because they went with that canon rather than this canon, the Alexandrian canon, the Protestants have a different Old Testament than we have by seven books and parts of two others. And that's the canon problem. Although, like I said, they usually translate those. They just don't put it together with the other ones. They don't call it Apocrypha and list them. You know, I mean, TBN spent all kinds of money and did a movie on Esther. You know, and then sure they included parts of that was left out in there. But so that's the difference in our canon. That explains why the Protestants have a different Old Testament than we have. There's an historical type of that. Okay. Do we have time to do this? Yeah, I guess we do. Now let's go back to what we call a breakdown of these books. So now we've got this Old Testament, and the Protestants and us have the same canon for the New Testament, the same 27 books. All right? They may not like some of those books, like James, for various reasons, but they're there. Okay. And they use them. So how are we going to take these books, since we now have this library we call Bible? Because everybody wants to classify books. If you go to a real library, they used to do a decimal. What do they do now? I don't know what they do now with things on iPads and stuff like that. How do you do stuff? I don't know. But, you know, but you always categorize books. You know, where do books belong? You know, let's group them into a group so that we can kind of look at them as a grouping together. You know, so you go to a library, you get the sports books, you get the philosophy books, you get, right? So we do the same thing as Christians. We're going to break these books down into certain types of books. Now, the traditional way to do this for the Old Testament, from the Catholic, from the Christian point of view, is to break them into the four groupings. There's the first five books. Of the Bible. They're known as the Pentateuch, aren't they? In Greek, that's the word for five books. Pentateuch, five scrolls, five books. Pentateuch. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. Okay? Then there's a whole group of books. They're usually referred to as the historical books. This is where I need to get my notes. I can't rattle them all off. Joshua, Judges, Ruth, 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings, 1 and 2 Chronicles, Ezra and Nehemiah, Tobit, Judith and Esther, 1st and 2nd Maccabees. And then there are books that are termed wisdom books.
Father, what's the biblical novella's introduction over Tobit, Judith, Esther?
Excuse me?
The
biblical novellas. You've got something I don't have.
That's in this.
It's biblical novellas.
Is over the Tobit, Judith, Esther, and Maccabees in the table of contents?
Well, I don't know. I don't have your table of contents. They're usually are just written up in different ways.
Okay.
A novella is like a short novel.
Okay.
I'm using it different. You're using something different than I'm using.
The NAB.
Okay, well, that's okay. I mean, the scholarship is different.
Okay.
The wisdom books would be things like Job, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Sirach, and Wisdom. Okay. And then you got all the prophetic books. Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Amos. All those other kinds of things. And so historically, that's how Christians divided the books up. Into Pentateuch, historical books, wisdom books, and prophetic books. Like Daniel, in the Christian division of the Old Testament, is listed as a prophetic book. Okay. I don't like that. And that's not the way that the Hebrews divided the Old Testament up. And so what I wanted to do was to give you the way that the Hebrews do it. And also give you the word that the Hebrews use, because they don't use the word Bible. So let's just go from that. They don't divide their Bible into four parts. They divide it into three. They don't call the first five books Pentateuch as such. They call it Torah, which means law or instruction. For them, that was the most important part of their sacred scriptures. In Jesus' time and afterwards, when they had a synagogue service, the most important reading was the first reading. It's not for us, though, is it? The last reading is the most important. And it was from Torah. most sacred part of sacred scripture to a Jew. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. The second part was Nevi'im. N-E-V-I-I-M or N-E-V-I-I-M. That's the prophets. That was the second reading in Jesus' time in the synagogue service. So when he stood up to read from Isaiah, that was the second reading of that synagogue service that Sabbath in Nazareth. And then the third part was called Ketuvim, which means the writings. And that would include things, and that's broken down into three parts we'll talk about here a little bit. Okay. Notice T-N-K. The Hebrew word for the Bible is T-N-K. Tanakh. So if you go to Barnes & Noble, and you're looking for the Jewish scriptures in Hebrew, it won't say the Bible. It will say T-A-N-A-K. Remember, no vowels. T-N-A-K. Tanakh. That's what the Hebrews thought their sacred scripture was divided into. Notice there's in a certain sense, there's no real history book. Okay. Now, Torah was those first five books. The prophets, the Nevi'im, was divided into the latter, the former, and the latter prophet. Former prophets, Joshua, Judges, Samuel, and Kings. And they didn't divide them into 1 and 2 Samuel or 1 and 2 Kings. So for them, the former prophets were essentially four scrolls, four books. Okay. Joshua, Judges, Samuel, Kings. Now we divide Samuel and Kings into two books each. 1 and 2 Samuel and 1 and 2 Kings. The prophets, the latter prophets, were either what they called the major prophet or the minor prophet. The major prophets were Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, not Daniel. The minor prophets were 12 in total, starting with Hosea and Amos and so on and so forth. And they usually were referred to as the 12. And these 12 books, starting with Hosea and going through Malachi, who was the last of the minor prophets, their books all fit on one scroll. The major ones needed a scroll for each book. And if you pick up Isaiah, you know it's a long book. Jeremiah, it's a long book. Ezekiel, it's a long book. The reason why they were called major had to do with the length of their book. Not that the fact that Hosea is not important. Hosea is very important. Because Jesus quotes from Hosea a lot. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. Knowledge of God, not burnt offering. That's from Hosea. Okay. So you have, we'll come back to this, but you have the 12 called Minor Prophets, and they're part of the Latter Prophets, and the Former Prophets are books that in the other group would have been called historical books. Now, this tells you something, that they saw these books as not being history in the sense that we think of history. If somebody went out with a camcorder and just recorded and then wrote it into words, what happened? You know, it's God speaking through the people that are in that book. They're thought to be prophetic books. And they're telling people about the covenant, because that's what prophets do. They tell you about the covenant, how poorly you've been keeping the covenant. Okay? And that kind of thing. So you have the prophets. Then you have these three things called the writings, which for them were everything else. And in the writings, in so-called wisdom writing books, were things like Psalms, Proverbs, and Job. And then there were a bunch of books they clustered together, five of them, and they gave it a special name called Megillot, which is M-E-G-I-L-L-O-T. And this includes books like the Song of Songs, you know, Ruth, Lamentations, Ecclesiastes, and Esther. And then the third part of the Ketuvim, or the writings, were the books of Daniel, Ezra, Nehemiah, and Chronicles, which they didn't divide into two books. We divided into one and two Chronicles. Now, the reason why I like this, number one, is I like the idea that it's divided into three. Okay? And I like the idea that these books that we think of as history books, like Joshua and Judges, really are prophetic books in the sense that they speak, God is speaking about how to live and everything else through those books. It's not like it's just a regular history book that we pick up a book about the history of the Revolutionary War or something like that. There's prophetic things in those books. Okay? And it's also, for me, rather easier to understand. There's Torah, the Law, the Prophets, and the other writings. Makes it easier. You can know the other grouping if you want into four, that's fine too. But I kind of like this. The word Nevi in Hebrew means somebody who's called. A prophet is somebody who's called. Okay? Prophetes in Greek means one who speaks for another. Okay? But in Hebrew it was one who's called. So somebody's called. Amos is called. Last week at the readings during the week, we had readings from Amos. This Sunday, you're going to have a reading from Amos too. And Amos is called from being a farmer and a grower of sycamore trees in the southern kingdom of Judah. And he's told to go to the northern kingdom of Israel and prophesy about their social injustice. And we're going to find out in that first reading this Sunday that the prophet up at Bethel, the house of God, a shrine in the northern kingdom of Israel, to keep them from having to go to Jerusalem to the temple, the king of Israel would set up sanctuaries and holy places and have his own prophets and priests and everything else up there outside of the temple in Jerusalem. And when Amos gets up there, the guy's name is Amaziah, and Amaziah says, go back where you came from. We don't need you. You're a southerner. You're not even a northerner. What are you doing up here? You know, we're doing very fine, thank you. You know, we've got the natural resources up here in the north, and we're very rich up here. Yeah, we got a lot of poor people too, but that's their problem. We're doing very fine, okay? And you go back to the south and earn your money there, prophesying. And Amos says, oh, no. I'm not like you, Amaziah. I'm not a royal crony. God called me and sent me here to prophesy against Israel. I make my money dressing sycamore trees and being a farmer. I don't do this for a living. I'm not a professional prophet like you are. God called me and said, woe unto you if you don't change your ways. And that was about 750 B.C. In 722 B.C., the Assyrians destroyed the northern kingdom. Okay? That's what we need. So, Nevi in Hebrew means one who's called. It was translated into a Greek word, prophetes, which meant one who speaks for another. And a prophet then is one who speaks for God. Amos spoke for God. He was God's prophet. When you hear the thing in the first reading in church on Sunday, you're going to see that Amaziah is a priest of Bethel. He's not a priest of God. So the writer of Amos says, wait a minute, this guy's not really authentic. I, Amos, I'm the authentic God here. God sent me to prophesy. I'm speaking for him, and this is what he said. And then the other writings has become a mixture of things. The reason why I like that is it shows that the book of Daniel was written very, very late. And it shows how the canon comes about. The canon gets cut off at a certain point